Welcome back. Today, oh today, do we ever venture, ever onward. Last stream, we got being able to sort three integers efficiently. We also got print out all the unique letters, whichever one that was here. Yeah, I forget which one that was. I think it was 35, Duplicat Vernichtung. I probably butchered that. So, we have three goals left here. I think each of these bottom lights has to do with efficiency. So, for dramatic tension, let's start with 38, and then 40, and then 41. So, just to remind you, the objective of this particular problem is to print out the digits of this number from the hundreds digit to the tens digit to the ones digit. And I happen to pick an implementation where I keep track of how many hundreds there were, then how many tens there were, and then finally how many ones there are. Alright, so first I check, is the number less than 10? No. Is the number less than 100? Yes. And then split it into its digits. Compare, is the 3 less than 10? Nope. Or yes it is. So then go onward. Pretty straightforward. And then we like check, is 143 greater than 10? Sure is. Is it greater than 100? Yes, it's greater than 100. So, the first digit is going to be a 1. 43 is less than 100, so print out the 1. I mean, this is... If you've ever had to translate between binary and octal and hexadecimal and so forth, and you're familiar with this sort of operation where you keep subtracting a 10, or subtracting an 8, or subtracting a 2, or a 16, or whatever base you're in. Keep subtracting that until you end up with the respective digits. And, yeah. It's pretty simple and straightforward. So then we have a 4, and a 3, and you get the idea. We do the same thing with the 587. So this is how you achieve separating a integer into its composite digits. Well, composite's the wrong word, but separating it, expanding it into its digits. I feel like I'm speaking over my music here. So yeah, I did this in 29 instructions and 202 cycles. Can we do better? Well, it depends what your definition of better is, really. So that was my latest attempt, which was 29. My first attempt here is also 29. Did I do the same thing? If I did the same thing, then why do I have two separate programs? Let's take a look. Oh, I think I just reordered some jump instructions to try to get it to be more optimal somehow. So even last time I was in here, I was trying to optimize it. Are these two the same? 29 versus 29? I want to say the last two programs are the same. They look the same to me in terms of what instructions they are comprised of. Yes, these 2 and 3 are exactly the same. Okay, well, I'm going to blank out slot 3 and try this from scratch. So if I wanted a program that's going to execute this in the fewest number of instructions, yeah, I think a reasonable step is read the number, copy it somewhere, maybe even pre-fill some zeros. Yeah, that would not be a bad idea. Let's copy from the 0 to the tens digit, because we just might need that tens digit later. Read the number. Copy it into the 0. I wish they'd put this like 100, 10, 0, and then it'd be pretty clear to everybody viewing this what value and what column means what. All right, so read our number, subtract 10. And if we're zero or negative, ooh, that's ugly. I don't like this very much, but okay, bump. And then if we're negative, you know, I don't feel like doing that. In fact, yeah, that's going to produce incorrect behavior and inequality condition. So if we're negative, then just add 10, print it out, and we're done. Okay. For numbers greater than 10, either way, we'll still want to add the 10 back. And then subtract 100. Here's an idea. 100. Oh gosh, that looks awful. 100. Okay. Man, this is a creative way to label your stuff, eh? I have a feeling that writing with a mouse is... I don't like that. Whatever. Here, for completeness sake, 100. I'll have to register this font sometime. It actually makes some of the reading this a lot easier. Subtract 100. If we're negative, dot, dot, dot. Then we just want to separate this into tens and ones digits. Otherwise, if we're greater than 100, we want to copy the result back to here and then increment the hundreds digit. Which means in the first place, we will need to prefill the hundreds digit. And then jump back up here. Okay, so oh wait, let's focus on functionality first and then worry about optimization. I was about to change my mind, switch tracks here and try to start optimizing this, but I'm not ready yet. So jump, subtract 100. Oh, wait. Read the value in again, keep subtracting the hundreds. Then when we're done, add 10. Oh wait, we've already copied the number. Yeah, I don't like this add 10 anymore. We're gonna read that. And I don't like this add 100 anymore. There we go. Yeah, I'm just gonna use copy from 0. Anytime I need to read the value, there's no point in doing an add when a read is just as fast. Because apparently in this language, reading from memory is as quick and inexpensive as doing an add operation. Now even more quick would be if you had two hands. You know, just putting some ideas out there in case the developers of this game are listening. Two hands. Just saying, make that happen. At least make it a mod. Confuse the bejesus out of everybody trying to play this game. I don't know, you have to make that a sequel, basically. Because that would be way too difficult for most people playing the game. But I think it would be fun. All right. Sub 10, jump if negative, else, read that, sub 100, jump if negative, to down here. Either way, we're going to have some kind of loop down here, where we're going to, again, do sub 10. After having read the value. And say jump if negative, blah, blah, blah. And otherwise, just jump back up here. Copy to zero. Increment the tens digit. Pretty simple. Why didn't I come up with this the first time? Okay, first of all, no, I do have my jump at the very end of this. I just don't have to read out the values instructions. Hey. Dot dot dot. Jump if negative will take us down here. Oh, but if I hit this the first time, it doesn't want a leading zero, is the point. Well, I know how to filter out leading zeros. Oh god, I feel. Okay. Copy from 2. If it's 0, don't print it. This is so hokey, but it works. Yeah, now, I'm actually trying to tune this for performance the whole time. Oh, wait, no, this is what got me in trouble last time. I can't do this because I could have a hundreds digit, but have no tens digit. Yeah, we'll see. I might get another hash table thing going. Alright, so subtract 100. And if we're less than 100, why don't I do that check first? If I'm going for performance, I can't afford to do things in a sensible fashion. We're gonna start this over. At least we keep our labels. So copy our 0 into our hundreds digit, into our tens digit. Arguably, that's something we only conditionally need to do. Also arguably, before any of this, we should increment the 0 to be a 1. I'm going to increment that. And since I'm incrementing it, 1. Alright, so when we redo the loop, we're not going to increment that again. That's just going to be the first time. Oh, shoot. I need a 0 and a 1. Heh, heh, heh. Okay, well that's dumb. So this is actually going to be our 0, if I can draw a 0. There we go. We're going to copy from 0, copy to here, and call this 1. Again, I want this to be legible. There we go. Simple. Alright, I'm going to save all this for later. Read the value from the inbox. Copy it to address 0. Subtract 100. If we're negative, then do other stuff. Else... going for performance here. Subtract the 10 while we're at it. If we're negative, skip over this. Otherwise, yeah. Either way, we're gonna cop. Wait. We've already copied the, no, we do need to copy the resulting value into 0 here. Copy the 1 into both digits. Otherwise, gosh, this feels hokey. I have a feeling I should have saved the sub 10 for later. Yeah. I'm complicating this way too much. This is not the time to complicate. Subtract the 100. Copy to 0. Copy our 1 into the hundreds digit. You know, let's figure out how to save on initialization later, too. So in each iteration, we're going to copy some zeros. I probably don't even need that one, just the tens digit. Subtract 100, copy to 0, copy from the 1 slot into the hundreds digit, and then read the number again. Well, here's a thought. So I don't have to do so much jumping later on. Again, we'll figure out the most efficient way to do this later, but put a 1 in the hundreds digit to begin with. We may or may not need that one. Subtract 100. Oh, but the whole point of copying the 1 was so that I don't have to do the bump here. No, we can subtract 100 again. Right, this actually skips a step. That might sometimes be unnecessary. Here's another crazy thought. Put a 1 in the tens digit. This is gonna get... We're gonna have lots of jump instructions, which you would not normally see in assembly. Because jumping is generally super expensive and bad. But here, it's perfectly fine. Okay. So we do need to save that result. Here, increment the hundreds digit. Then reread our value and jump back up here, like that. So keep subtracting 100 over and over. Once you're done subtracting hundreds, then we have the correct digit in the hundreds place. So yeah, just read the digit, print it, and then figure out what to do about the tens digit. Subtract 10 from our value. If we're negative at this point, then we're going to skip the part. I want to do in here like another subtract a 10 sort of thing. And another comparison. So the point here... point was going to be that since we were initialized a 1 in the tens location, that we could do some trickiness. Like, if subtracting 10 puts us negative, just read a 0 and put that in the outbox. Otherwise, we're going to have to do our loop and eventually jump over this stuff. Okay, and if we're negative here, then we have to copy... I'm sorry, if we're positive, we have to copy a result, then increment the tens digit, and then read our value again, and get ready to subtract 10 once more. So we printed out the hundreds digit, the tens digit. Okay. Subtract 100 and we're negative, then we're going to need to do our whole routine where we're going to read our number, subtract 10, and if we're positive, then get into this loop where we're subtracting 10 a second time, just like we have above. But I'm not allowed to declare subroutines in assembly code. At least not this particular flavor of it. If we subtract again and we're negative again. Then... Oh, wait. Oh yeah, the last thing we have to do here is read the final digit, print it, and then jump back up to the top. So it's case A is numbers less than 100. Or greater than 100. Case B is the stuff we're doing here, which are numbers less than 100. And there's going to be a B1 to B2. If our number's less than 10, just read it, put it in the outbox, we're done. If we're greater than 10, check are we greater than 20. If we are greater than 20, save this number. Copy... Wait, we have to increment the tens digit. Then reread the number. And then jump back up here. And subtract a 10 again, and so on and so forth. Until such time that... Okay. So when we're done with all of this, in this little greater than 10 branch, we want to read the tens digit and print it. So on and so forth, and back up to the top. Alright, we'll see how this performs, guys. Yeah, that's some... If this works, that's some serious cheese. Well, it worked for that set of inputs. He's going to give me some inputs where it fails. I look forward to seeing this one. One in a... Ooh. Wait, what? How? What? Okay. What was my input that failed? 10. So I put a 1 in the hundreds digit, 1 in the tens digit. Take a 10. Subtract 100. Copy from 0. Subtract 10. If we're negative, we jump down here, which we're not. Oh, do I really have to... Oh my goodness. I do need to copy this result into the digit. So there's my ones digit. Don't I have to do something similar with 100 here? Yeah, in fact, I did something similar with 100, I just didn't do it for 10. So my program worked for everything other than the number 10. Amazing that he docks me for that. Okay, what did we do wrong this time? Just after I got through saying that, oh yeah, this works just great, So I have a number ending in 13. Oh. Yes, I have to do the same thing down here. See, my routine worked for numbers, where the tens digit is not one. You can see in terms of how many times he runs up and down the board. I saved a few steps. Let's see, how'd we do? 189. We can do better. We can certainly do better. See, the next thing I'm tempted to throw in would be doing multiple decrement steps at once. And then if I end up with a positive integer, I'm sorry, if I end up with a negative integer, then doing a decrement on the other side. Practically speaking, I mean, yeah, you could do some serious loop unrolling stuff here. To come up with the most optimal solution, I think. But I want to just partially unroll a loop. So like here, where I'm subtracting 100, I have to copy my intermediate result there, and then I subtract 100 again. I'm talking about what if I don't copy the intermediate result every single time? I mean, what's the use in copying these intermediate results anyway, right? The use is that eventually I will need to, after getting the hundreds digit, I will need to extract the tens and ones digits. So I will need the number in hand to be positive. Oh, I'm sorry. The other point of storing the result is so that I can bump as I'm doing here. But something way more aggressive I could do would be bump subtract twice, right? Actually, why do that, right? Am I right? I'm always right. Okay. Yeah. 20. That looks terrible. That looks disgusting. Let's try that again. 20? No. Okay, let's do it the way they told us to do it in school. I've never got this one working. 20. 200. Okay, let's try that again. 200. 0, 1 more. Nope. This needs to be perfect, guys. Close enough. Yeah, just a little bit. If I'm going to be spending enough time with this, I need the digits to be something that don't disturb me throughout my interaction with the game. Copy from 10. Copy to 20. Oh, wait. Copy from 10, add 10, copy to 20. Copy from 100, add 100, copy to 200. Alright, so that's how we get our 1, 20, and 200 there, right? So, my goodness, why subtract 100 when... Yeah, let's do this here. Subtract 200 in each intermediate loop. I'm actually just going to do bump twice. Wait, no, I can get a 2. No, but this also does a write step. So there's no point, as of right now, in doing things differently. All right, so jump if negative down here. And then add 100. If we're still negative. Wait, how do we end up down here? Subtract 200. We get a negative number. Add 100. If we're still negative, I think I need to bump a value. How? Okay. this is disgusting. Wait. Bump -2. Which indeed means I need to initialize this. No. This gets way ugly. I think this will be fine. Loop unrolling. Please tell me this works. At least this produces the correct result. That isn't quite working. Does that look like it's working to you? That does not look like working to me. Copy from 0, subtract 200. Wait. Where did this go wrong? Give me a number of starts. There we go, 413. Oh, my 200 is not a 200. That's how it went wrong. There's always a catch, guys. Yeah, let's try it with a number greater than 200 first. Jump if negative. Okay. Copy that to here. Bump. Bump. Copy from 0. Subtract 200. Oh, I never wrote the value back to the first register. For negative, yeah, this is probably not going to work very well. The more I look at it. What I really want is not this, but a 200s routine, then a 100s routine, and then a 20s routine and a 10s routine. For me to get there is going to be a total, utter, complete mess. Well, no, I could start undoing some of my changes, but how far do I go back? Okay. Let's see. Copy to 20. I'm probably, yeah. So here we got to the point where things are still halfway sane. Copy from 10, add 10, copy to 20. And then let's start with the simple thing first. So let's say our integer truly is less than 100. Let's just deal with the tens digit stuff down here. Sub 20. Jump if negative. Copy 2, 0. Increment 1 twice. Copy from 0. And then jump back up here and subtract. Actually, if we're going to read from 0, We can just do that that way. Then when we end up with a number down here, let's see how close we are, first of all, because there's no way this is going to work. Let's try that again. 237's wrong. Can I get a number starting with a 1? I cannot get a number less than 100 starting... Oh, here we are. 49. Good enough. So what would I expect this to do? It'd be kind of nice if you could draw in some of your own numbers here. And, anyway. So read the number. Subtract 20. If the number's less than 20, do things the tens way. That's probably fine. Although I want an inner loop here. Let's see. Subtract that. Increment this twice. And then when I'm all said and done, subtract 1. Probably I'm no longer off by 1. So I expect to jump. I expect not to jump. Increment this twice, increment this twice, decrement it, and then go back to my routine down here for handling tens. So I expect this should slice this up into a 4 and a 9. Okay, that's not a 4. Oh, because I already started right. Yeah, this is why I need to do something different the first time through this section of the code. Copy to 0, bump 1. Maybe I should put another bump minus 1 here. And I don't know. This is getting ugly. Why would I want to do that? I'm trying to avoid an off by 1 error. I'm not doing very well at avoiding that. Jump if negative. I'll take us down here. It just seems wasteful to do this. And it is wasteful. And it's incorrect in some cases, too. So yeah, when all said and done here, I do want to add 10. And see if we're still negative. Oh wait, this is an unconditional jump. Meaning this extra stuff I'm doing down here is not going to make any bit of difference. Okay. For negative... I'm sorry, for less than 20, count the 20s. Why does this not work again? Oh, because, right. We're saying for less than 20 at some point. We don't know if we were less than 20 the first time. And I initialized our tens digit with a 1 instead of a 0, because I thought that was clever. And suddenly that's not feeling so clever. Subtract 20. Really, I want to do something exactly like what I did down here. Except initialize things slightly differently. Based on whether initially this was greater than 20 or not. I want to initialize this to a 0 or a 1. Now that won't do either. Let's try doing this comparison right away. But we're still off by one in some cases. Oh wait, and this jump will take us... this jump should take us somewhere different. Right, rather than going back up here, I want to read the value and then jump back into this loop. And then our last iteration, I want to do an add 10 and see just how far off are we. If we're still negative after having added the 10, then we need to decrement without incrementing. I'm still off by one. Because I initialized this to a... Yeah. I need another bump plus one in here somewhere. Or minus one. Because I initialized this to a one. Now I subtracted 20 twice. Let's try this. Trial and error. Let's see how close we get. Okay, we're off by one this way. Take our 24, subtract the 20. We're not negative. Copy the 4 here. Increment. Copy this. Subtract the 20 again. Add the 10. We're still negative. We're still negative. Yeah. Then we need... I still need an additional bump plus one down here. I think is my point. So what I'm attempting to achieve is half as many loops. And twice as many wrong numbers. It's not the goal, but it's the outcome. Yeah, let's try that again. I'm actually curious. Yeah, what happens if I just have 9? We'll figure out that 9's less than 10, right? And also less than 20? It's definitely less than 100. Yeah, so just read out the 9. Here, let's see. That doesn't start with the tens digit. That starts with the tens digit. 93, 53, 13. Oops. Did I not read the number into the outbox? Because I was being dumb. Subtract 10. Heh. Right. So the first thing I need to do needs to be comparing my number to 10 to see whether I have a tens digit, because if I don't do that comparison first, I lose sight of it. So all this stuff is great, but it's based on a flawed premise that we can reorder our instructions at will. The answer is no. We need to check, are we greater than 10 first? If not, just print out the ones digit. Else, then we get into tricky stuff. Or we can check, well, is our number minus 10 greater than 20? If it is, then we want to copy our number minus 20, doubly increment the tens digit, and reread our number, and subtract again. If our number is in fact exceeding, or I'm sorry, if our number is not greater than 30, then we want to reread the value. Okay. So this should cut that number of loops almost in half. There we go. So I can apply that same technique across this entire program to reduce the number of loops. So you see all the times he's going up and down and up and down and up and down. I can cut that in half, if not more. You see the program is exploding in size, but that's okay. Now, this technique we're doing here with the tens digit, let's use the same technique for the hundreds digit, and then worry about what to do about the tens digit in the case where we're greater than 100, where we know we're always going to have a tens digit. Copy to 0. So the next thing we're going to do is going to be subtract 200. For negative, do this, else, inside this loop, go back up here, after having read the value. Then when we're done, subtract a 200. I mean, perhaps for simplicity's sake, I think it's slightly simpler to understand this. Jump if negative, we want to just re-add the 20 that we just subtracted. And then up here, if we subtracted 200 and we got a negative number, we just want to re-add that 200. Okay, copy 20. Doubly increment the hundreds digit. Yeah, it's the same thing. I'm curious. Where's this jump taking us? Yeah, this jump doesn't need to take us all the way back up there. This jump can take us here. That's more efficient. I was trying to figure out what was different between the top and bottom halves of the program, and that was the difference. It's that we're jumping a greater distance than we needed to. I was also wondering why the previous execution was slow. Oh, there's nothing in the 200s digit. You know, I might want to fill that. 100 plus 100 is 200. Now, arguably, I could take this a step further and have a 400s digit and a 40s digit, and then I wouldn't need a 20s loop. Because either the number is greater than 20 or it isn't. It's cute how he grabs the one. Well, this program just keeps increasing in length. That's okay. Alright, so now in our case where we have a number that's greater than 100, which is the majority of our numbers, it seems, or at least a good many of them. How to handle this is a good question. Subtract 10. If we're negative, then we're just going to print out 0 in the ones digit. otherwise, after having subtracted the 10, we're going to subtract 20. That's not 20. This is 20. If we're negative, we're going to add 20. Confused why I have this copy to zero. This might be redundant here. Anyway, if we're not greater than 30, then we do want a copy to zero. So I'm gonna just take that extra instruction and move it up here. Doubly increment the tens digit. And read in our number again. Jump back up to here. Now, I've avoided cleverness thus far. There are more clever ways to try to write this, most of which are probably wrong. So we'll see if we get the correct answer, and if not, then tune for correctness. They tell you get the correct result and then tune for performance. I'm doing exactly the opposite. Okay, so he tells me that, yeah, you did it right for those values. Here, let me give you some values which don't work. Let me give you the 411, he says. Okay, so that was the point of that copy instruction that I got rid of. Copy from 2 to outbox. Read our number, subtract 10, and irrespective of what result we get, I do need to copy this result into the ones digit. Because later on, we don't copy this into the ones digit. So like after this is sub 10, I should say just this needs to go into the ones digit, because we're going to need to print the ones digit later. Now, it wouldn't surprise me if my instructions were wrong for some other input. Ooh, look at that, a negative 3. What was our input number? I was paying zero attention. 207, 407. So yeah, that thing I just said about it doesn't matter what the result is, it actually kind of matters. Subtract 10. Here's our subtract 10. We only want to copy a positive number into the ones digit. Now, I know how to optimize this further with the 400s digit and the 40s digit. Apparently, that's what the game wants me to do. Apparently, that's what we're doing. Okay. So I'm going to add a 20 and copy that to 40. This seems silly. Now, if I'm going to be adding 4 at a time, I'm going to want a 4's digit somewhere. So I'm actually going to, after I've got our 1, add 1. Add 1 again. Whatever, there's multiple ways to do this. Let's copy our 1 to here. We're going to call this 4. And then we're going to increment 4 until it actually is a 4. Okay, so the reason we have a 40s digit, let's practice down here with numbers less than 100, and then if we get this right, worry about the rest. Jump if negative. Okay, instead of subtracting 20, we're going to subtract 40. Actually, having a forwards digit is not very helpful. Because I would still have to read, increment by 4, and then write. So, screw the 4. We don't need it. Okay, so if we have a number exceeding 50, we're going to do this, and then add 40, actually, add 20. If we're negative, we're going to skip over doubly incrementing the tens digit. Let's see. Otherwise, yeah, we're going to end up doubly incrementing the tens digit and then reading the value. That looks fine. Otherwise, we do need to add another 20 back on. Oh, wait, we need to jump again. Which means I'm going to need a sub 20 here. Subtracting 40 gave us a negative number. Then we need to add a 20. Yeah, no, this has to be add 40. As much as I'd like to avoid that. Avoid adding a 40 and then subtracting a 20. There's no avoiding that. Okay, and if we're negative here, we need to add the 20 on. Subtract the 10, and so on and so forth. This might shave off a few instructions on average. Or a few cycles on average. Probably not enough. I probably need to use this technique elsewhere in the program. Say for the 90% of numbers that exceed 100. So, let's do that. We know that my approach works. We're able to troubleshoot it for a simple use case. I need to just insert that same approach up here. Copy to 0, subtract 40. If we're negative, skip over all this. When we're done, we need to re-add 40. And in here, we want to copy this, read it, and in between, bump the tens digit a few times. Okay, that's probably reasonable. It's probably not going to get much better than that. Oh, we need a jump at the end of this. Back up here. Here we go. None of our example numbers here saved us any cycles with that 40. So I could apply the same technique with the hundreds digit as well, and see if we have any numbers greater than 500. Oh, look at that gradual savings. Ever so gradual. At 200, right? Alright, so here, same technique. We don't have a 400s digit yet. We will need one. Add 200. Copy to 400. Let's try that again. Let's try that. Nope. There we go. 400. Good enough. No, that looks like it's making a face at me. I can't stand with that. That's better. Copy to 400. Alright. So, let's subtract 400. If we're negative, jump down here and re-add the 400. And else, go back this way. In the interim, copying our result here. And reading it back out of there, and incrementing some stuff. Now, I wonder, might it have been better to do this with numbers like, I don't know, other than 100, 200, and 400? There might have been better pivot points to use. We'll see if this works for 803. Yeah, this got me no benefit for 803. It would have to be 903 for me to see some actual benefit. Alright, so. So, I'm starting by subtracting 100. Right? Because I need to see if there's a hundreds digit or not. Maybe I want to use 30 and 300 instead of 40 and 400. It just seems like I would get the best savings if I... I don't know. Let's try 300. Nope. This part is clearly... Yeah, okay. There we go, 300. Good enough. Alright. And then when we're initializing this, we want to add 100 rather than adding 200 and decrement one fewer time there. Do we get any better performance out of this thing? I certainly hope so. That actually didn't help on the average case. I didn't think it would. So I think I'm going to go back to 400. I didn't see a compelling reason why... Oh, come on. Get rid of the instruction. Make this 400 again. So far, I haven't tried to do anything overly clever about reading and writing into memory addresses and Like, I could tune this to, instead of issuing four bump instructions, to add four and write it. For me to do that, yep, that's what I was alluding to earlier. Need to do this. 2, 3, 4. All right. And then this, instead of that, would be read the hundreds digit, add 4, copy to the hundreds digit. And other places, like here, this would be copy from the ones digit, add 4, copy to the ones digit. I didn't think this would make a very large difference. Because we're not going to end up inside this condition very often anyway, I don't think. And it takes some instructions to put the 4 there in the first place. But okay, I'll give this a go. Yeah, where we get more performance improvements is by reordering our if statements. We're still off by 8, guys. I think this is the point where I have to start reordering my statements to see if I can do things very marginally better. Like here, where I'm doing the subtract 40 first. Why do that first? Why not subtract 20 and then subtract another 20? I don't know. Or when we're done, why do this add 40 and then subtract 20? It just seems like there's some room for improvement, however slight. Like, if I could add 20 and then jump into this loop, that'd be great. But jump also costs an instruction. Also, if I could just check if I'm, like, just do some incrementing at the end to account for the fact that I've overshot my target. And then decrement the value in the tens place accordingly. Like, I think that would help too. Like, if I just keep subtracting 20s until I get a number, until I've overshot my target, and then decrement my tens value as necessary, I think that would help. I'm not sure how much. Find out I should actually do that inside the more complicated loop, because a good number of these integers are going to be greater. Well, anyway. Oh yeah, so I was saying the other thing is, like, if I know my number is greater than 100, then I know I'm going to have a tens digit. So let's get past all this hundreds counting stuff. Now here I subtract 10 and jump if negative, right? And okay, that's kind of sort of clever, maybe. It would be better if this whole routine, I don't know, if the first thing I were to do here was like subtract a 40, see if we're greater than 40. Let me see if I can do that. Now, the reason I did the subtract 10 here is because I initialized the tens digit to a 1 rather than a 0. And it's possible that maybe that initialization is just stupid. Where am I doing that initialization anyway? Copy a 1 into slots 2 and 1. I'm not copying a zero anywhere, so this might save a step somehow. Probably not. Anyway, that's off by one performance issues. I'm looking for some kind of much larger performance gain. It's like when I'm reading my number, yeah, the first thing I want to check is if I'm greater than 40. And if so, do my whole 40s routine. Then check 20 and then check 10. Why don't I experiment with the hundreds digit instead? Where do I get any marginal benefit out of this subtract 400 thing? So this only benefits me if my number's 500 or greater. Right? Now I have to check first if I'm greater than 100, and only then can I start tinkering with other stuff here. But yeah, numbers. This is fine though. How much of a performance gain do I get? Like, if my number's less than 500, this extra subtract the 400 and compare and add 400 doesn't gain me anything. But if it's greater than 500, then sometimes it saves, like, one loop or something. Well, it might save also some bump instructions. Like, here we were bumping the hundreds digit, whereas here we're, doing an add. So that's one fewer loop, one fewer comparison, and so on and so forth. So yeah, this is actually good. This is fine. I can expect that on average this will save something, and that changing this to a 300 wouldn't save as much, because I'd be going through this loop more times then. So there's a trade-off there. Now the other thing that could be done is not have a 400s loop and a 200s loop, but just have a single 300s loop. That wouldn't execute so many times anyway, and it would be more likely to be called than this. So let's try that. In fact, this jump here is kind of gratuitous, isn't it? Because the only case where we'd actually end up falling into this loop a second time would be if we're greater than 899. 90% of the time, at least, we're not going to end up going into this a second time. So I don't need this to loop back. I think that's my key here, is that just don't bother jumping back. But then what am I going to do with this gratuitous, like, add 400 step? Yeah, just don't jump back up here. This is going to look awkward. Instead of jumping, just subtract 400. And then add 400. And instead of jumping after adding 40, we're just going to subtract another 40 to offset the add 40. And then elsewhere here, there's another, yeah, here's an add 40. Rather than jumping, we're just going to subtract 40 and that. Oh man, loop unrolling here is crazy stuff. Wait, how many steps did that take for the 803? That seemed like a lot of steps for our 803. Oh, because, wait. I don't understand. I do not understand. Well, for one thing, these subtracts to offset the adds. This could just be a jump instruction that just jumps us over that. Skip both. So that'll save an instruction right there. And then likewise for the next time we do a subtract to offset an add, just skip over the add. Don't do the extra subtraction. And down here, skip over this add. That's how you save instructions. That's just so contrary to the way I normally think about how programs should work. Because normally you don't want to be jumping all over the place. At least to spaghetti code that you just don't want. But it's okay. We're making progress, guys. 116 lines of code. 169 cycles. I'm starting to run out of ideas. I mean, do I also say that I don't want to... I don't want to loop for all of my 20s and 200 cycles? I mean, looping here seems to make a lot of sense. But if we're saying that this just leads to too much overhead overall, then I don't know what I want to do. Maybe I don't want to loop. Let's start with... Wait, so this already took us... It just feels like this particular jump and the similar thing we do for the tens digit could cause some headache. And maybe it's not worth doing this more than once. Let's try this. Okay. And then the same thing for our 20s loop. Instead of taking us back into there, just skip past all this. And for our other 20s loop, just go down past all this. Yeah, let's try this. Let's see how we did. We're getting there, one cycle at a time. Oh, check it out, we got it. All right, so the key there was just don't do so much looping. And do tons and tons and tons of branching. All right, that, yeah, I tend to think of this left branch as the set of challenge problems. So I'm not so sure why I thought that would be easy. Other than it was before year 40. Here we are in year 40. Read the prime factory of the inbox into the outbox, sorting from least to greatest. Oh, I'm sorry, this must be prime factors. So, here we are, integer 1. Got the number 3, increment that 1, See how many times 2 divides into 3. So our remainder's 1. Now why am I checking this? There's got to be a more efficient way for me to implement division. So we figured out that 2 does not divide evenly into 3. We also figured out that 3 is 3. 3 divides into 3 exactly once. Just something I don't have any kind of special check for. And really I should. Once my loop iterator... I don't have a multiply operation. But at least once my loop iterator is half of the number that we're checking for the prime factors of, then if I double my loop iterator and get a number greater than this number, then stop trying to do all this division and just print out the number because it's prime. I'm gonna hit the washroom and be right back. Do enjoy this animation. Also, I apologize, I just realized now that I'm streaming this in 20 FPS. And it's not beautiful at all this way. I usually stream most animated games, things other than chess, I usually stream at 30 FPS, so you can just appreciate all the beauty that is in this picture. So that said, I'm surprised this is working at all, but apparently it is. Anyhow, we got the idea. I'm going to be back in just a moment, and we'll get to see this in a more beautiful quality. In the meantime, run, computer, run. So those are our prime factors, guys. 3, 7, 2, and 2. Alright. Be right back. Don't go anywhere.